So we've been in the middle of this series about resetting, and we've talked about things like resetting our hearts, resetting our clocks, resetting our tools, our technology. And this week we're talking about resetting our bodies. And I think that this is, one, it's just kind of this perfect fit for wrapping up all of this. Like when let me back up a little bit. When you start a church plant when we're, you know, a little over a year old, you start to have these moments where you're like, anxiety that things that you never really cared about before. Like the anxiety of what would a heavy snowstorm the night before church look like, right? Like, and luckily, people came together. We got everything plowed. It's a little bit less people, obviously, in person because of the snowstorm today. But all of this stuff, and I was sitting back there, and I was just praying, and I was kind of talking to God and during that worship set. And I just sat there, and I was like, how cool is this? Like, as I look around and I see, and Matt put it perfectly, the faithful people that had four-wheel drive that could make it today. But when Jamie and I first started praying and walking through planting a church, and our hope was, we hope somebody other than somebody with the last name Engler shows up. That was our first prayer, you know. And then the second was like maybe like 20 people would come. That would be like a huge success. But to see what God's doing, and some of that, as we walk through that, and to understand that we even as a church have to go through a little bit of a reset period. And I went, God, thank you. And I started praying for each of you guys here, people online, also people here, just going, what a beautiful day for a snowstorm to reset. To reset just who we are as a church, reset who we are and what we're going through. And again, I'm reminded of the heart, the clocks, the technology. And today, talking about resetting our bodies. And I just want to make it very clear to set up this sermon. This is not like, I'm not, you know, we talked about this last week when I talked to Mike about this, where I'm not fat shaming anybody today. That's not what today is about. You're safe. You know, you don't have to worry about that. I'm also not going to break out the old, you know, health curriculum teacher in me, and we're not going to be discussing our bodies ourselves. That's not what today is going to be about. Like, I felt like just all of a sudden I saw a bunch of panic on people's face. Like, I remember those books, and I remember how awkward that was in those middle school years. We're not going to be doing either of those things. Today we're just talking about that God has given you a temple. God has given you this body to take care of and all the aspects of that and to understand. So when we talk about that, the verse that everybody uses when they talk about this is 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 17. Do you know that you are God's temple and that God's spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy and you are that temple. So this verse is used over and over and over again for people. And they talk about like your body is God's temple. And I agree with the overall part of it, but you have to dive in deeper and you have to understand a few things that's going on in 1 Corinthians here. First of all, when he's talking about this, this is not you like your body. This is your body. Like this is plural form. So you have to understand that what he's saying is all of you, you're to corporate together is God's temple. So it's taking care of, you know, yes, I have my physical body, but it's taking care of more than just my physical body. It's all of us together taking care of each other. And you have to understand too what's going on here in 1 Corinthians is to understand Corinthians is written. Paul's writing this, so Paul, you know, is writing a letter to all these different churches, and Paul is a follower of Christ that's writing this kind of encouragement, but also like, hey, here are things that you need to fix as a church. So he's writing to the church of Corinth here, and the church of Corinth, to understand the city of Corinth and what's going on, is it's a port town that is not really known for, let's just say it's the early Las Vegas of its day. Maybe that's the easiest way to put it. Not the best things happen there, you know. Like what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. If that saying was what happens in Corinth stays in Corinth, right? Like there's a lot of women at the port waiting for them there. If I sold it enough, Jamie usually looks at me and is like, the point's taken. Shut up now, right? Like it's not the best town, and it's not known for that. And Paul's writing this message and going, God loves you. Your temple, who you are physically, who you are individually, who you are, all of your church together, you have to understand that God loves you and this is your temple and you need to treat it that way. You need to not just give away those things. You need to do that. Over and over, different jobs I've had. One of them that I've shared before is the city of Midland. I was safety trainer for them, and I ran through the seasonals, and Brenda can attest to this. One of the first jobs I would do is I would run through this three-ring binder with all of the seasonals that work there, and I would go through, and I'd talk about hearing protection. And that was the one that they, like, 16 through 24-year-old are not the smartest time period for young adults. And they think they can do whatever they want to do and like da-da-da-da-da. And, well, why do I need to wear a seatbelt? Because if you fall off the mower and die, it's not our fault, right? Like, we want to keep you safe. And we go through this. So I tell them, like, you need to put hearing protection in. There's a lot of loud noises. Like, I don't need hearing protection. So one of the things I do is I say, eat lunch at the old guy table. And I make them all go and like have lunch that day at the old guy table. And it's absolutely hilarious at the old guy table at the city building because they're all sitting there eating their lunches and they're trying to tell stories. And it's like, what? What did you say? What did you? And they're like you feel like you have to have a translator for them or like the, you know, the words underneath because they just can't hear anymore. And afterwards I say, that's why you need to wear hearing protection because these guys didn't and now they can't hear, right? Like, So it's the idea of keeping themselves safe. I was talking with an older gentleman this last week, and he talked about, going off to war. And when he went off to war, they said, they gave every soldier a pack of cigarettes. And they said, and he goes, I don't even smoke. And he goes, it's not to smoke, it's to actually stick in your ears. Like, because that way you won't lose your hearing. Like, an understanding, like, our body, you know, anybody that I would say is hit 40 or older can attest to the fact that your body starts to break down. You can't do the things you used to do. And I start to go, I really wish I wouldn't have been so stupid with this body. What? Well, so is he. So elbow him back. There's like elbows flying all over the place, right? Like this body that God has given you is meant to take care of. It's meant for us to care for. It's meant for us as a temple to watch over. It's meant, but the biggest part about that of why it's important is because we are an example. God has created us, and right, like, so others will see. And you hear my prayer, you hear us talk about this all the time. God has made you so others will see that and see God through that. So we are an example. So how we treat ourselves, and I know that I get up here and I struggle with many different aspects. But I work on trying to be better with that. But I know that part of how I treat myself and how I behave and how I act, people that are not Christians are going to see that and going to react to who I am and how I handle that. But my life should be an example of what Christ is. And I found this quote from this pastor, and I don't even really know how to say his name. It was 1800s. And it says, a Christian is a person who makes it easy for others to believe in God. Like, we're an example. How we treat ourselves, how we treat others, how we act is an example for how others can see God. Me being a Christian, right? Like, that's what I need to walk through. I need to understand that. And when I rip apart others or when I tear apart myself or do stuff that's not healthy or right for myself, I'm actually tearing apart God's creation. I'm tearing apart who God made me to be. We need to understand that we're an example, right? We're an example to how we act. So I've been walking through many, many different health changes and trying to be this. And as we reset, I've shared every week, like this sermon series, I hope you understand is for me as much as it's, you know, as I'm preaching for you guys about us being better with our heart, us being better with our time, us being better with our technology, us being better physically, like taking care of ourselves. Like one of my good friends, and he sat there and we were talking about his health and different things that he's been going through, and he's went through a lot of health concerns. And he looked at me and I said, you know, hey, you need to probably see a doctor. Like this is, and he's like, but if I go and see a doctor, then they're going to tell me I have a problem. And I said, no, whether you go and see the doctor or not, you have the same problem. you need to go see the doctor. And I get that it's tough. It's right. Like you go through that. And I hate going to see a doctor. I hate because I get discouraged. I ended up this week going to the doctor because I had this little, you know, my brain was going everywhere because I apparently, I didn't know it was a thing. When you sneeze hard enough, you can actually hurt your trachea. And so I damaged my trachea. And he's like testing for all this cold and all this different stuff. And no, you don't have, you know, the typical, all the tests now of you don't have COVID, you don't have this, you don't have this. And so that was Monday. And I was like, no, I feel great. And he's like, yeah, your glands aren't swollen. You're completely fine. And I'm like, okay. And he's like, you just damaged the cartilage. And it was like, okay, I went to the doctor, checked that off the list. I woke up Tuesday morning and I couldn't breathe and I had a sinus infection. I'm like, I went to the doctor. What? Now I'm sick? Like, I can't call and be like, can you see me again today? Because now I'm actually sick. Right? But it's taking care of ourselves. It's taking care of that. And some of those times we have to go through that. And taking care of who we are physically. And this, again, isn't to be about overweight or whatever. It's what is God convicting you about? And as I've went through this and I've did this, one of the resets happened. Again, this entire sermon series was inspired from things that our family was going through back in November. And one of those was going to see the doctor and have him go, hey, you know, I'm not saying it's bad, but your numbers aren't going the right way. You've been going really, really well for a long time and your numbers aren't going the right way. And so I went through this and one of the things he said to me, I said, I put all my food in my phone. Like I have this app and I list everything. And he's like, that's great. And I said, my calories aren't that high. And I showed him and he's like, I'm not saying you're doing this, but understand you can have 2,000 calories a day. And if you're eating 2,000 calories a day of peanut M&Ms, that's not a healthy diet. And it was like mind blown, right? Like, what do you mean? Peanut M&Ms, there's protein in it, right, Trey? Right? Like, there's nothing wrong with that. And he's like, you have to look at the macros. You have to look at all this stuff. So I started going in and I'm like, oh, and I went back through those days and I'm like, oh, I'm eating not healthy at all. Even though my calories were fine. My calorie intake was okay, but the food I was putting in wasn't healthy. And he's like, and here's the thing, John, I'm telling you right now, because I see it all the time, don't go stupid on me. And I looked at him and I said, what do you mean? He said, I have people come in and I tell them their numbers are bad, and then they go on some stupid diet, like soup-only diet or liquid-only diet, and Abby can probably attest to people that do this, right? Like they come up with all this stuff and or, you know, don't go keto, don't go all this stuff. What you need to do is have small changes because those small changes can make big results. And I thought of that with our faith, right? Like, and I've went through that and I was like, okay, I'm going to make some small changes. I'm going to continue to put my food in and I'm going to look at this and I'm going to try to be healthier. And, you know, it was Christmas time came and I had 2,000 calories of cookies, you know, Christmas cookies every day. And I said, okay, soon as Christmas, kind of like that video, soon as this, and I'm like, nope, I'm done. I need those small changes. Here are the small things. I'm going to look at it. And I actually reached out to Abby this week because I was starting to struggle because I hit a plateau where I'm like, I've been doing well. I feel better. I have less headaches. I feel like I have more energy. I feel like I've lost this weight, but nothing more is coming off and all of this stuff. And she said, well, some of those small changes, you just have to tweak around. Is that the right word that you like? And we were talking about the carbs, like, and yes, you can have that many carbs, but are you eating them in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening? You know, when are you? Just look at those small things and see those, make those small adjustments and see what's going to come out of it. And yes, it's helped me physically be better. It's helped me, other than this last week of being sick and not really having any energy to do it. So let's take out this last week of that. But right, I feel like I'm looking at my wife and looking for the yes or no. Like I feel like I've had more energy. I feel like I've been more present. I feel like resetting that health has done that. So as we do that in our faith, right? Like as we reset our faith, those small changes of diving in the Word. If you sit here and go, okay, John, after today, I'm going to do 2 hours in the Bible every day. I would look at you and be like, No, like kind of like that doctor. Don't go stupid on me. Find small changes. Those small changes are going to be the big results, right? Like, I love my quiet time in the morning. So in my quiet time in the morning, instead of watching some mind-numbing thing on my phone, I'm making sure I'm doing a devotional. And, you know, I love for the most part, that my kids and wife are in bed and asleep by 8:30. So I have the house to myself from 8:32 on every day. It's this wonderful thing. Someday my kids are going to stay up after 8:30 and I'm not going to know what to do. But I have that time at night. So I get a chance to talk to God at those moments. I get a chance to pray. I get a chance to do these things, like to make these small changes. And I've noticed who I am. I'm happier. I'm better. I feel like, and nobody shake me off on this, I feel like I'm more enjoyable to be around because I'm spending time with God. I'm spending time doing those things that are important. I'm caring for my body, you know, and you can sit there and you can be discouraged because that's what really happens, right? Like we start to get discouraged and we go through there and we see those, plateaus, right? Like, I forget, your definition of plateau was like really good and I should have wrote it down. But it was talking about like the plateaus, like this is when we define a plateau, when it happens for a sustained week after 4 weeks, and then you have this plateau. And to understand that your Christian walk is going to be the same way. You're going to make a change and you're going to feel great. You're going to feel connected to God. You're going to feel like, hey, this is what my faith is all about. And then at the end, they're going to hit this plateau and you're going to be like, okay, what's the point anymore? And you have that choice to continue on, right? Like pretty much my text to Abby was, I want to stop this because it's not fun putting in all my food and looking at my macros and going, hey, I'm trying to stay at 150 carbs. Between 150 and 200 carbs. It's not fun to look at all this stuff when I have no result. And sure enough, you know, I get on the scale this morning, I'm like, oh, there's another big jump in lost weight. And like, look, this is fun. And like, I feel more energetic. I feel more, like, you go through those moments. Our Christian faith is the same way. We go through those moments when we reset our faith, when we reset where it's going to feel like things are going well. And maybe in this series, God has been tugging on your heart about resetting something. And you feel like, hey, I'm getting this. Like, things are going well. And then you just feel like it's like, oh, God, seriously, I need something. And you have to look out there. And that's where I get back to the original point with resetting. Like, I look at how beautiful this is. And yes, I love on Sundays when this place is packed and we don't have enough parking and there's 10 people waiting to use the bathroom. Like, I love those Sundays. But I also love this Sunday, where a moment that we get to reset and have a smaller group and just praise God together and grow together in our faith. Like there's beauty in that. And to wake up and go, how are we going to get the snow taken care of? And having people that are willing to come and shovel and do this and take care of this. And it's just so amazing to see God dive in and people that are willing to do announcements and make coffee and clean up hot chocolate that was white and yellow on top because it sat for too long. Like, clean up that stuff. Like to clean up the messes that happen because the church is dirty and the church goes through all this stuff. But to have people dive in, and I go, there's beauty in that. There's beauty in those small changes and seeing those big results in lives that are changing because we're willing to make those small changes. When it comes to treating each other in our bodies, it comes down to the fact that, you know, we can't look at the mirror and we can't look and go, oh, I wish I was this size. I wish I was this. I wish I was this. You know, I used to have dreams when I was a little kid, and it was funny now to look back on. And I used to have dreams that my biceps were like huge, and I was like this ripped like person. I'd walk around, and it was like, I want to be like that someday. I wouldn't be able to move my arms at all, right? I'd be like I wanted like 80-inch biceps and all this stuff. Like you had these dreams of this like perfect body that you wanted to have. And it, right? Like we look at magazines, we look at different stuff and we say, I wish I could look like that. And instead to say, man, this is what God's given you. He's handed you this temple to take care of. He's handed you this body to care for. He's handed you this and it's up to you to take care of that. And it's not just, you know, right? Like it makes me sick when I look at the world and what they portray. Like I look at my wife and my daughter and I see the things that they feel like they need to look like to be able to be called beautiful. And it breaks my heart. I look at for my kids, for my son, like the things that he has to strive for to look a certain way. The same for you guys. And it drives me crazy inside where God just says, you're loved. I've given you this temple to care for. Please stop looking in that mirror and going, I'm not perfect. Because it gets back to, again, that very same verse in Corinthians and all as messed up as Corinthians was looking at. The entire idea that I take out of that was it was not about caring for me. It was about caring for we. He was writing to the entire church to say, your body is your temple, each and every one of you. So if I come to you and I text Abby at some random time because I'm trying to be better about, you know, as a health coach, like to eat better, to do this, then part of her job as a Christian and part of this church is to help walk through that, all of the different aspects. It's caring for your body and caring for this. It's a we thing. It's in all of us. It's us spurring each other on. It's us encouraging, saying, hey, I love that you, I've noticed that you've been working on this and you're better about that. How can I encourage? How can I help you? It's not about going, hey, I know you're trying to be count your carbs and I know you're trying to be healthier and I know you're trying to do this because it's important to you. So I baked you a chocolate cake. No. It's about walking through it and helping and to give and to say, hey, it's okay. Let's do this little part, right? Like one of the things that Jamie has helped me the most with in this is she hasn't stopped baking those wonderful desserts, but I feel like I'm a little kid because she divvies up my section for me and brings it to me. Because she knows if I cut the piece of cake, it's like I've cut, you know, like that little piece and I take everything else with me and leave the little piece behind. But right, like it's that portion control. It's that helping to be better. It's that understanding or for her to go, hey, I know you need some time, so I'm going to give you this time. I know you need this, I'm going to give you that. I know you're struggling with this, I'm going to pray. It's the we thing. It's about caring for all of us together. Those small changes will make big results. And if we come together as a church and we say, hey, let's help each other care. So when you look at that part of the temple, when you look at that, it's not about me saying, hey, you need to lose weight, you need to do this, you need to grow this, you need to do whatever. It's about me saying, what is it that God's convicting you about you being better? And let me help you do that. Not let me point out all of your flaws, all of your mistakes. But what is it that God's calling you to be the best version of yourself? And let me help you achieve that. Let me help you as a church come together. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you for being a God that loves us each individually, but us also corporately, us as a church, for spurring us on, for the greatness that you've created in each of us to be better, to want to be better, to be stronger, to be more like you, so that others will be seen, not us, that others will be seen in all that we say and all that we do. God, be with us this week. Be with our challenges, those moments we feel like giving up. Maybe we've hit the reset button too many times and we're just saying, I'm just done. Be with us in those moments. Be with us in those struggles. In those times that we just feel like we want to give up. Those moments that we say, I've learned this lesson already, God, I don't need it again. Walk through that with us. Provide support and love as we grow closer to you so that others will see you in all that we say and all that we do. It's in your name we pray. Amen.